Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God and Father, you are the source of all that is good and beautiful and true. We thank you for all of your blessings, too numerable to count. We ask the blessing of your presence here with us today as we celebrate this landmark in the lives of these young men and women and their families. Thank you also, Lord, for the gift of joy that we all have today. As these young people leave this place, may they always look to you for guidance, and always remember to give you thanks for your blessings. And may we all continue to grow in our knowledge and love and service to you today and always. In the name of Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit live and reign, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. Welcome to everyone. It's a great privilege for me to welcome you to the 35th commencement exercises of Trinity Preparatory School. I would like for everyone to turn off cell phones, beepers, or pagers for the duration of the ceremony. I'm deeply grateful to those members of the faculty and the staff who've worked so hard to prepare for this ceremony today, especially to Mac Hall, Sherry Hay, Marty Pulaski, Donna Curran, Randy Rolick, Gene Olin, Alex Jaroff, and Roger Schutzmeister. And I want to thank each of you that have come here this morning to celebrate in the graduation of the 101 members of the class of 2003. The H. Benton Ellis Award was established in 1987 to honor the memory of H. Benton Ellis. Father Ellis was a much admired and respected member of the science department at Trinity, and he also served as Trinity's second headmaster. This award recognizes excellence in teaching. The winner is selected by a committee of former winners. I'm pleased to welcome Mrs. H. Benton Ellis, who will announce the faculty recipient for 2002-2003.
It is indeed a privilege to be at the 35th Trinity graduation. Thank you, Mr. Mom, for inviting me to present this award. Benton's educational realities concerned the whole student. He felt that the influence of each and every faculty member was a compilation of that faculty member's academic and life achievements. This year's award winner has been active as an advocate for other teachers. Determination to serve students at all times, thoughtful consideration of issues, and sound judgments are primary concerns of this faculty member. The firm foundations in subject matter, as well as life, that are instilled by this faculty member provide the firm base for the years of education that follow. Service to Trinity on different boards, as well as a team leadership, exemplify the dedication of Lenita Brown. Congratulations, Lenita Brown, on being selected by your fellow faculty members.
And I'd like to take this opportunity to recognize the outstanding work of our entire faculty. Would you please join me in expressing our appreciation to the great job they've done? Representing the class of 2003 are three outstanding scholars. They have distinguished themselves in the classroom and in their extracurricular activities. Desiree Akavan is a member of the National Honor Society, the Cum Laude Society, the French and Spanish Honor Societies, and the Mu Alpha Theta Mathematical Society. She has received awards for excellence in chemistry, Spanish 1 and 2, and pre-AP French. Her extracurricular activities include track, forensics, the Literary Society, Amnesty International, and Habitat for Humanity. She will attend Boston University in the fall. Please welcome Desiree Akavan, salutatorian of the class of 2003.
When people ask me if I'm sad to leave, my answer sometimes surprises them. Sure, I have my share of nostalgic moments, but I'm more excited than anything else. Call me optimistic. We've been preparing for this moment since we knew what the word graduation meant. The numerous fundraisers, assemblies, and not to mention classes, have led to this point in our lives. Regrets are left in the past, because from now on, it's forward. But I'm still taking my memories with me, with or without a frame. I vividly remember my first day at Trinity, a day of transition into a new world with more people and more homework. It was a time for change, a new beginning, a time to meet new people and make new friends. Change is good, I thought. I can start anew. And I got off to a great start. I'll never forget running late to my first class with Mr. Denicol. But soon enough, he began to call me by my nickname, and I began to feel like part of the school. Besides being there to ease our transitions and guide us academically, our teachers have been wonderful friends. The value of a teacher is often underappreciated, and we seem to conveniently forget their important role in our development. A great teacher is described in the film The Emperor's Club as having little external history to record. His life goes over into other lives. These men are pillars in the intimate structure of our schools. They are more essential than its stones or beams. They will continue forever to be a kindling force and a revealing power in our lives. Students, on the other hand, are an opposing force that tests our strength. All the same, we're slowly maturing. We formed friendships with each other, and while some are perhaps more superficial than others, there are those bonds which will never be broken. When after 10 years of not hearing from a friend, a hug will make it feel like nothing has changed. Because though we may try to deny it, life goes on and we lose touch. But as long as that bond is sincere, our hearts will reopen to its warmth. And yet, why wait until the next reunion? We can conquer the odds set by the generations in the past and the stories of their youth and lost acquaintances. We've got cell phones, email, and instant messenger. In the end, most of us did get to know each other, at times learning a little bit too much. But sometimes we overlooked the strong character of a bookworm, the family life of someone whose character you may have questioned, or the vibrant spirit of someone who you thought just got good grades. In retrospect, I'm sure we all could have added an extra smile here and there, an extra hello. But how else would we learn if unable to look upon our histories with each other? High school has been a time to build our characters, to enrich our minds and our hearts. But so is life a never-ending journey of such expansion. Ask any author what to write, and he'll say, write what you know. Well, that hardly makes a short story. We've met Voltaire, Hamlet, Carl Jung, and Martin Luther King. The insights which spew from our lips astonish us, and our parents would be scared to know just how brilliant their children are. But it's only begun, for life is a journey of education. It broadens our horizons and sharpens our perceptions, adding new twists to the plot. Whether we pursue higher education or have a profound conversation with a stranger, our experiences will further our understanding. This journey is like following a rainbow. While we may never reach the pot of gold, we mustn't overlook the beauty along the way. As your journey progresses, surround yourself with people that love you and will love you no matter what. This ultimate bond exists within our families. I could not have reached this point if it weren't for that fortress for well-being, which gives me the greatest strength besides faith, love. My sister Celine selflessly gave me her ear anytime I wanted someone to talk to, and she's now and forever my best friend. My aunt Nika is cool beyond words, and I could turn to her with any problem and learn from her experiences. My grandparents have given me unwavering support and advice and have always been on my side. While my parents have unfailingly given me their love and support, they, on the other hand, haven't always been on my side, per se. They sometimes seem to play on the opposing team, such is the definition of parents, but they are covertly planning an offside attack. You only figure it out once the smoke is cleared. After all this, thank you seems like such an empty expression. But nevertheless, I truly thank you for nurturing me, and I love you so much. I will never forget the friends that have eased my days at Trinity. You'd think we were adults trapped in little bodies as we debated philosophical issues, venting about stress and giving each other support through it all, for the good and the bad. I thank you. As we prepare for university, I still think that change is good. But I don't want to reinvent myself. I think most of us have become happy with who we are, though there's always room for improvement. Improvement, however, must be our work. It cannot be dictated to us. Charles Schwab said, "A man who trims himself to suit everybody will soon whittle himself away." To my fellow classmates of the class of 2003, no matter what you do in life, do it to make yourself proud of the person you have become. Never let anyone cause you to feel inferior. Dignity is a feeling inside you, and unlike pride, only you can hurt it. Remember that you have a combination of qualities unique to yourself, not to mention the variety of talents among us. We are a symphony composed of history buffs, runners, and painters. But it is also the hidden talents that must be uncovered, the digital photographers that haven't yet been displayed, the shy poets. Though we have different capacities, greatness comes from how much of our capacities we achieve. Everyone has his own pace, but in the end, there's only one finish line. It's just up to you as to how you get there and what you achieve along the way. I can't help agreeing with Mark Twain that it is curious that physical courage should be so common in the world and moral courage so rare. My dear friends, we now have the chance to make our marks outside the bubble. Whether you move the world or inspire one individual, your everlasting contributions will rouse change. Our educations will help us be a beacon of light that will illuminate the world. Don't be afraid to stand out. Don't be afraid to fight, and don't be afraid to shine. As you choose between two divergent paths, learn from the mistakes of others. Be open-minded. Create your own opportunities and turn disadvantages into advantages. It all begins with a bold dream. The second step leads to the launching pad. Don't let fear incite hesitation, for as Wayne Gretzky says, you miss 100% of the shots you never take. I know we're all sick of hearing this, but carpe diem. Education should complement your life, not prevent you from living it. Follow Picasso's philosophy. Only put off until tomorrow what you are willing to die having left undone. If Robin Williams would grant me one wish for you, it would be happiness. Happiness is all-encompassing. It means success, knowledge, virtue, health, and love. If you could take only one thing with you to college, take that, and hey, you won't even need a suitcase. The notion of leaving Trinity brought back memories for a lot of us. We seem to revert back to our state of grace, discussing highly mature matters such as the Power Rangers and Animorphs and My Little Pony. We supported our theses with the source of ultimate power, our squirt guns. Our overused minds followed a circular path, while our heavily caffeinated bodies continued straight on until Judgment Day, but not without stopping by at Starbucks and Chick-fil-A. As we remember our days at Trinity, snapshots of friends, teammates, teachers, and even detentions are brought to life. We've reached the final thrill of the roller coaster, but there is still an entire amusement park left. And sorry, guys, but it's bigger than Disney. 5 years of my life spent on this campus. Granted, we're all taller, well, most of us, but there is still the senior rock. There is still a name tag that says Gladys. There is still the teacher who made fun of my drawings and who still searches for exotic birds on campus. And there are still the friends who love one another no matter what. I ended my high school career by being late to my last class. It's comforting to know that some things never change.
Chad Clark is a member of the Cum Laude Society, the National Honor Society, and Mu Alpha Theta Mathematical Society. He's also a member of the National Junior Classical League and is a National Merit Scholarship finalist. His extracurricular involvement has included Quiz Bowl, Latin and Chess Club, varsity track, and junior varsity baseball and football. He received awards for distinguished achievement in Latin 3 and 4, History 9 and 10, and Honors Anatomy and Physiology. He will attend Georgetown University next fall. Please welcome Chad Clark, co-valedictorian for the class of 2003.
Good morning. Before I begin, I would like to personally welcome the families of the graduating class. I think I speak on behalf of everyone here in thanking you for attending and for your contributions to each of our lives. You have instilled strength and morality in us all, and without you, we would not be the same people we are today, nor would we have accomplished as much. For the memories we share and the blessings that you bestow upon us, I would like to say thank you from the bottom of my heart. I would also like to take this moment to thank every one of the teachers who have dedicated countless hours to preparing us for college and beyond. They have done an incredible job, and one that's not easily done. Their dedication to their profession is a gift to all of the lives they touch, and I would ask now that you join me in a round of applause to thank them. Like many of the graduating class, I was part of the Parkey influx that matriculated to Trinity during the seventh grade. The middle school years were some of my favorite years. Aside from the fact that I had less homework and frankly just a less stressful life, I had my close group of friends who I had been with for many years before, and I was just very happy in my comfort zone. Anyone who knew me then knew that I was very hesitant to be noticed and really just enjoyed being one of the crowd, so to speak, unnoticed and left to my own devices. I hardly ventured outside of my small group of friends, and I absolutely hated to be put in a position where I might actually stand out or be forced to put attention to myself. Suffice to say, times have changed. In ninth grade, two of my closest friends left, and some of my other friends ventured into new groups. And for a couple of years, I didn't really have any sort of social direction in my life. Now, that's not to say that I was by any means lost, but I just sort of drifted along like most kids do, not always sure of their place among everyone else. I mention this because I'm not the same person today that I was just a few years ago, and there's a valid reason as to why. Do you ever wonder what makes people afraid? Most people desire the chance to succeed, but why is it that when opportunity arrives, oftentimes we find ourselves looking the other way? Think for a second how many times in your life you've thought of something in the past and said, you know, I really wish I would have done that, or I wish I would have handled that differently. Well, the most important piece of serious advice that I have ever received is that if you are to be successful in life, no matter what it is that you pursue, whether it be in school, in the workplace, sports, relationships, or anything else that you can think of, you cannot be afraid to take risk, because only when risk is coupled with hard work will your greatest successes come. A couple of years ago, Geneva Brundage and I attended a leadership conference in Massachusetts. The program was run by a man named Fitz, who, like our beloved Mr. Rhodes, was quite bald, yet still very brilliant. As I started to understand what he believed, I came to greatly respect him. And one day he asked me to tell him why I felt so resistant to venture outside of my safety zone. And you know what? I didn't exactly have an answer for him, not one that he would accept anyway. He told me exactly what I just told you, that if I ever wanted to achieve anything, I was just going to have to suck it up and put myself out on the line, even if it made me incredibly uncomfortable at times. I decided to take his advice, and I found out that he was right. There have been plenty of times in my life where I failed to act because I was too concerned about what could go wrong instead of being focused on what could go right. Hard work will take you far in life, but hard work without confidence, without the ability to inspire greatness in yourself and others by taking those risks, will oftentimes leave you far short of your potential. I was visiting Georgetown about a month ago, and the assistant academic dean talked to us about college and what to expect. He said something that really spoke right to this very issue. Now, I'm not a big fan of using metaphors in speeches, but the example that he used was dead on. Think about the next 4 years ahead of you, your time in college, and your life after that as a river. Now, it's very easy to sit back and let the current take you to wherever you're supposed to end up. You can take orders from everyone else and have them push you along in life. And some of you who do this will probably be successful. And if you're happy with that and that works for you, then great. But if you're like me, and you desire more from yourself, something more than just the bare minimum or status quo, then you've got to make the decision to let go of your inhibitions and put yourself and your skills up against everyone else. I can speak from personal experience that ever since I made the decision to take risk, my life has been more successful in school, in interviews, relationships, you name it. Two of the very best people that I've ever met and two of my most meaningful friendships, those of Lauren Brown and Maxine Riley, I owe to taking risk. It won't always be successful though, and if you take this to heart and truly act upon it, be prepared, because I can guarantee you that sometimes those risks that you will take will just blow up in your face. Those times are not fun at all, and they're not easy. But many times the best things for us aren't easy. Deciding to be a risk taker means realizing that failure and disappointment are a part of it, and you undoubtedly will experience that from time to time. But the knowledge that comes with every failure brings you that much closer to victory. And in the end, your successes will be more prominent, more frequent, and far more gratifying. You'll find that when you're willing to take risk and do so with confidence, that other windows of opportunity oftentimes present themselves, sometimes even out of failure. What do you have to lose? If you don't develop a sense of ambition, you'll never know what you could have gained. And in the end, isn't